Hey, what's up, you guys? I'm super excited for this video today because today we're doing a long-awaited topic that a lot of people have been asking me, which is to reveal my entire portfolio. So today we're gonna do exactly just that. We're gonna reveal my entire RBC portfolio, which is the majority of where my wealth is concentrated, and it's gonna be an exciting video. But before we begin, let me just give a reason why I've been so hesitant to make this video until now. And that reason is I don't think that the size of your portfolio should really matter in the grand scheme of things. So I didn't want this to be a distraction, right? So I know a lot of you are just starting out your investing career and you might not have that much money. And I know a lot of you might have a lot more money than me invested in the stock market. But unless you have like $10 million or $100 million, or unless you're just investing with like literally $100 or something like that, unless you're on like either end of the extremes, I think in general, if you're somewhere in the middle, like most of us, I think in general that your investing strategy should stay relatively the same. You should always focus on finding companies that have good fundamentals and investing for the long term. Now that's just my opinion. So I didn't want the size of my portfolio to kind of be a distraction. But however, I'm doing this video now because enough people have asked me to do this video and enough people have asked me to just reveal the size of my portfolio and the specific stocks that I'm holding at this moment. So that's exactly what I'm gonna do. I'm gonna reveal the size of my portfolio because, you know, why not? I always give the people what they want. So my portfolio as of today, June 19th, 2020, comes out to $35,198.02. And now these are in US dollars. So you'll see both it listed in Canadian and US dollars. So it's just the way that RBC displays things, right? Because I'm Canadian and based out of Canada. So it'll display both numbers. It's just automatically converted using the standard rate. So it's not both numbers combined. So it's one or the other, right? So you can either look at it as US dollars or Canadian dollars. But for the sake of this video, I'm gonna just use the US dollars as base because my RBC account is where I hold the majority of my stocks and the majority of my stocks are in US dollars. So just to make things easier, I'm just gonna explain everything in terms of US dollars. Now I realize $35,000 might be chump change to some of you, but I just gotta say this. This is all money that I earned from internships, from my salary, and from capital gains that I've gained from investing in the stock market itself. So this was not money that I inherited. I did not have the frat boy starter kit or anything like that. And my dad didn't give me $1 million of a small loan like the way that Donald Trump's dad did. So I didn't have a small loan of $1 million to begin with. I had to start from scratch, right? So this is a portfolio that I built from scratch all by myself, just working at an internship, making maybe like $20 an hour. I probably could have even saved a lot more if I had just been a little bit more diligent from the beginning. But hey, everybody's got to start from somewhere, right? And I realize a lot of you might be beginners and you're sitting there thinking, oh wow, $35,000 is actually a lot of money to a beginner. That might be true, right? So yeah, I just didn't want that dollar value to be a distraction as to our real goal, which is financial independence to retire early. So yeah, I just want to make a disclaimer before we begin. Now let's move on. So as you can see the breakdown, you will notice that a lot of my money is actually concentrated in cash right now, and that's because I just want to be prepared in case we have another stock market correction. Now you're asking, oh Andy, if you think that there's going to be another stock market correction, why don't you go 100% cash? Well, my opinion of that is that it's always risky to go 100% cash, right? So in case I'm wrong and in case that the market doesn't crash, I don't want to be left out completely, right? So which is why I haven't converted 100% of my wealth into cash. And in my opinion, it's always risky to do exactly that, right? It's always risky to have all your money in cash, which is why I haven't sold out of all my stocks. And again, I'm a long-term investor. So even if I buy stocks right now where stocks are pretty high at the moment, then I think that if I hold it just for like 10 years or so, or even longer, then I think I'll still make a decent return on it. I might not make the best return, but I generally try not to like time the market and do all this stuff. So that's why right now I think I'm already like 42% cash-ish. I don't want to go like too much more into cash. Maybe I'll go to like 50% if I'm like really bearish, but I really don't see myself going like anywhere close to 100% cash. It's just because I have a lot of stocks and I just think that the stocks are going to do well in the long term regardless of whether or not there's going to be a recession. So anyways, as you can see, that's my breakdown so far. And let me just go through all the stocks that I'm holding right now. So I'm going to start from the smallest holding that I have. And before we begin, just a disclaimer, this is my RBC account where I hold my US stocks. So if you're wondering where my Air Canada stock is and where my RioCan is, those are Canadian stocks. So those are in my Wealthsimple Trade account. So a lot of people have been asking me on my Costco video, oh, why didn't you use Wealthsimple Trade when you bought Costco stock? Well, the problem with Wealthsimple Trade is that because Costco is a US stock, it has to convert the money into US dollars because Wealthsimple Trade doesn't let you hold US dollars, which means that every time you convert, they will charge you a 1.5% currency conversion fee. So, you know, if you do the math, I think for me, I'd rather pay the $10 flat fee from RBC Direct Investing rather than pay the 1.5% currency conversion fee, which is variable as to how much money you're putting in. So I think that is still a little more worth it to just pay the $10 commission and just hold US dollars and just transact in US dollars, which is why all my US stocks are in RBC and all my Canadian stocks are in Wealthsimple. So if you're wondering why you don't see Air Canada or RioCan, it's because of that reason. Anyways, let's move on. So starting from the smallest one, the smallest stock that I have in my portfolio, in my RBC portfolio right now, is Disney. So I own 8 shares of Disney at a cost basis of $133.77. Now the market value of this position right now is $946, which means that I am down 11.5% at the moment. Now, I'm not really worried about this one just because I think that Disney is a really great company and they're going to do well in the long term. But obviously, in the short term, they've been really badly affected by the Roni situation, right? So Disneyland was forced to shut down. And I think that Disneyland in China was just allowed to reopen with social distancing rules and all these like modifications. So they've been allowed to open. But for the most part, Disney has been really badly affected because not only do they have Disneyland closed, they also own ESPN, right, which is a sports network. So as I'm sure some of you have noticed, there are no sports going on right now. So that's unfortunate. And Disney has been hit a lot in case because of that. But as I said, in the long term, I think that Disney has a bright future ahead of them just because of the vast wealth of intellectual property that Disney owns, right? So they own Marvel and they just bought LucasArts. So they own the whole Star Wars franchise. So all of these things, I think that they're irreplaceable. So some of you might have grown up watching Star Wars or watching Marvel movies or just Disney stuff in general, right? So a lot of you have been watching Disney stuff all the way from childhood up until adulthood and what led you to this video until now, right? So somebody, you know, comes out with a new media network and then they want to replace Mickey Mouse and they want to replace you know, your favorite Marvel characters, and they want to just make new superheroes and do all this stuff, they're probably not going to be that successful, right? At least not in the short term. It's just because I think that in the long term, people will still be nostalgic. And I think in the long term, people will still flock to Disney for their stuff. And you just can't put a price on nostalgia. Well, you actually can. It's the price of Disney stock. So I think that even at these levels, I know I'm down quite a lot. I'm down over 10% on this stock, but it's potentially a stock that I might want to average down later in the future, just because I think that they do have a bright future ahead of them. And I'm absolutely not going to sell Disney at a loss. That's just something insane that I would never do. So I might average down on this one. I don't know yet, but we'll have to see. So stock number two is NAT stock, which is Nordic American Tankers. Now, I know you guys are going to make fun of me. I've joined the tanker gang. But the reason why I own NAT is because I do think that they also have a bright future ahead of them. And that's just because, you know, back in the oil crisis back a few months ago, when oil prices became negative, I think Nordic American Tankers benefited a lot, obviously, because everyone's just rushing to find all this space to store all this oil, and there was just a vast oversupply. And I just don't think that that issue is just going to get resolved overnight. So I think that there will still be a high demand for oil storage in the coming months, even though that crude prices have recovered a little bit. But I just think that in general, you know, Nordic American Tankers, they're a huge dividend player, right? So last time I checked, their dividend yield was over 10%. And I'm actually expecting them to potentially maybe even increase that dividend yield in the future because they've just been raking in so much money, right? So I'm not sure if you saw that interview with the CEO of NAT on CNBC with Jim Cramer. So yeah, anyways, the CEO has been saying basically that NAT has never made as much money as they are doing now. And he's been in the business for decades, right? The CEO guy. So he's been in the business for decades and he's just never seen this demand and how much people are willing to pay to store oil. So I think that NAT does have a bright future ahead of them, and it's a bit of a spec play, but I think I got into this stock at a good cost basis, right? So I own 250 shares at a cost basis of $4.60. And right now, the market value of NAT stock that I own is $1,122.50. Now I'm down about 2.5% on my position, but then again, I'm not really worried about the stock price movements necessarily. I'm in this for the dividends, right? And I think that the dividends are going to be even greater than what they were before, as I mentioned. So yeah, I'm in this for the dividend. I'm not really worried about the price fluctuations, and I didn't make the mistake of FOMOing into this stock. So I know the reason why people make fun of the tanker gang is because everyone's just FOMOing into tankers when that huge oil crisis happened, right? So I think NAT stock hit like $7 at one point, and then it just promptly crashed back down. So if you bought NAT at $7, I would hate to be that guy, right? I would hate to be you because I think you overpaid for this stock. Now, I didn't buy into the hype and I just waited on the sidelines, and I waited till the stock came back down to earth till like $4 or to sub $5 until I actually decided to take the plunge and start buying it. So I think I know I said you shouldn't time the market, but sometimes with these stocks, especially these spec plays, you should try and just get in at a good time. And you should maybe try to time it a little, just because you know, you don't just blindly buy spec plays at whatever price, right? That's how you lose money. So I think I timed this one pretty well, and I'm pretty happy with the cost basis at the moment. So I think I'll be holding this stock for the short term. And yeah, if the stock skyrockets, I'll definitely probably sell it. But in the meantime, I'll just be sitting down and collecting the dividends as they pay out. So that's NAT stock. Now let's move on to stock number three, which is Microsoft, symbol MSFT. Now, I own 6 shares of Microsoft at a cost basis of $165.60. Now, I'm kicking myself for not buying more of this stock because now, obviously, Microsoft stock has hit an all-time high and it's worth much more than $165. So, I'm actually up 18.5% on this position, which would be a lot more money if I had just bought more shares. Now, I'm kicking myself for not buying more shares, but I should have. I would definitely average down on this if it ever hits $165 again, and I'm not sure if it ever will, but if it does, I'll definitely be interested in averaging down. So I already made a video on Microsoft, so I'm not gonna spend too much time talking about this, but essentially, to summarize, in case you haven't seen that video, I think Microsoft is one of the best plays on the stock market right now, and if you're a long-term investor and you just hold this stock and you just hold it for like 10, 20, 30 years and you just didn't sell it no matter what, I think that you're gonna make money, right? And I don't see a scenario where you won't make money. I'll leave it at that. And I think the CEO of Microsoft, Satya Nadella, he's one of the best CEOs in the world. I really think that Satya Nadella has transformed Microsoft and revitalized the company from it basically stagnation, right? So if you look at a stock chart of Microsoft, before Satya Nadella came, Microsoft was basically stagnating for a really long time, for like a decade, pretty much. And then Satya Nadella came and the stock just like went through the roof. So I'm very confident in the management team of Microsoft, and I just think that it's gonna be such a great play, and you can't go wrong with Microsoft, even at current prices. Even if it dips a little and doesn't hit my cost basis, I might even average up on this stock. So that's Microsoft. And stock number four is Costco. I just made a video about Costco, so once again, I'm not gonna spend too much time on this, but essentially the TLDR of that video was, I just think that Costco is such a great business. Every time I go to Costco, every single Costco I go to at any hour of the day, so long as it's open, Costco is always full. So yeah, Costco is such a great business in my opinion, and they're super well positioned to handle the new world of a Roni situation. So I think overall for Costco, Costco is here to stay. So Amazon is not going to be able to just quickly scale up groceries in a major way. Now, I know that Amazon's trying, obviously. They have their Amazon Fresh program and they have all their grocery delivery services, and they're trying to ramp that up. But the problem with groceries is that a lot of these groceries need to be refrigerated, and if you're Amazon, you can't just deliver groceries the same way you deliver other packages, because if something needs to be refrigerated and you leave it on someone's porch, it's gonna go bad. So it won't meet up to safety standards. So I think that for the most part, you can't beat Costco prices, and you can't beat the business model, which is buying in bulk. Even though everyone's shifting to e-commerce, for traditional retail, I still believe in Costco tremendously. So I think that this is just going to be such a great play. Now, I just bought this stock, and my cost basis is just over $300, and I'm just about break even. So I'm only down like 0.3%. So pretty much break even on this stock, and that's just because I bought it just a few days ago. So it's not gonna move that much within a few days, but for the long term, I think this is a great play. So I'm definitely gonna hold this stock, and I'm definitely gonna average down if the stock dips. So I realize this video is getting super long. It's literally over like 45 minutes, I think, at this point before I edit it. But even if I trim it, it's gonna be quite a while. So I think what I'm gonna do actually is I'm gonna break the video into two parts. So I'm gonna end the first part here, and then I'm gonna edit the second part and upload it at a later date, just so that I don't have to make you guys sit through a 45 minute video. So I'll end the part one here, and be sure to check back on this channel for part two. So yeah, stay tuned, and be sure to hit the like button if you enjoyed the video, and consider subscribing if you like this series. Be sure to follow me on Twitter and Instagram. I'll leave the links down below in the description as always. And with that being said, I'll see you guys in the next video. Bye-bye.